The Story of the Fisherman. There was a certain fisherman, advanced in age, who had a wife and three children. And though he was in indigent circumstances, it was his custom to cast his net every day, no more than four times. One day he went forth at the hour of noon to the shore of the sea and put down his basket and cast his net, and waited until it was motionless in the water. When he threw together its strings and found it to be heavy, he pulled but could not draw it up. So he took the end of the cord and knocked a stake in the shore and tied the cord to it. He then stripped himself and dived round the net and continued to pull until he drew it out, whereupon he rejoiced and put on his clothes. But when he came to examine the net, he found in it the carcass of an ass at the sight of his mount, and exclaimed, "There is no strength nor power but in God, the High, the Great." This is the strange piece of fortune, and he repeated the following verse: "O thou who occupies thyself in the darkness of night and in peril, spare the trouble, for the support of providence is not obtained by toil." He then disencumbered his net and the dead ass, and wrung it out, after which he spread it and descended it into the sea, and exclaiming, "In the name of God," cast it again, and waited till it had sunk and was still, when he pulled it and found it more heavy and more difficult to rise than on the former occasion. He therefore concluded that it was full of fish, so he tied it and stripped and planked and dived and pulled until he raised it and threw it upon the shore, when he found in it only a large jar full of sand and mud, on seeing which he was troubled in his heart and repeated the following words of the poet: "O angry fate, forbear, or if thou with no forbear relent, neither favor from fortune do I gain, nor profit from the work of my hands. I came forth to seek my sustenance, but have found it to be exhausted. How many of the ignorant are in splendor, and how many of the wise in the obscurity." So saying, he threw aside the jaw and wrung out and cleansed the net, and begging the forgiveness of God for his impatience, returned to the sea the third time and threw the net, and waited till it had sunk and was motionless. He then drew it out and found it in a quantity of broken jars and pots. Upon this, he raised his head towards heaven and said, "O God, you knowest that I cast not my net more than four times, and I have now cast it three times." Then exclaiming, "In the name of God," he cast the net again into the sea and waited till it was still. Then he attempted to draw it up, but could not, for it clung to the bottom. And he exclaimed, "There is no strength nor power but in God," and stripped himself again and dived round the net and pulled it until he raised it upon the shore, when he opened it and found in it a bottle of brass filled with something, and having its mouth closed with a stopper of lead, hearing the impressions of the seal of our Lord Sulaiman. At the sight of this, the fisherman were rejoiced and said, "This is, I will sell in the copper market for its worth 10 pieces of gold." He then shook it and found it too heavy and said, "I must open it and see what is in it and store it in my bag, and then I will sell the bottle in the copper market. So he took out the knife and picked at the lid until he extracted it from the bottle. He then laid the bottle on the ground and shook it, that its contents may pour on. But there came forth from it nothing but smoke, which ascended towards the sky and spread over the face of the earth, at which he wondered excessively. And after a little while the smoke collected together and was condensed, and then became agitated and was converted into an ephrit, whose head was in the clouds, while his feet rested upon the ground. His head was like a dome, his hands were like winnowing forks, and his legs like masts. His mouth resembled a cavern, his teeth were like stones, his nostrils like trumpets, and his eyes like lamps, and he had dishevelled and dust-coloured hair. When the fishermen behind this ephrit, the muscles of his sides quivered, his teeth were locked together, his spittle dried up, and he saw not his way. The ephrit, was soon as he perceived him, exclaimed, "There is no deity but God. Sullivan is the prophet of God. O prophet of God, slime I not, for I will never again oppose thee in word, or rebel against thee in deed. O merit," said the fisherman, "dost thou say, Sulaiman is the prophet of God? Sulaiman, past being dead of 1,800 years, and we are now in the end of time. What is the history, and what is the tale, and what is the cause of entering this bottle?" When the merit heard these words of the fisherman, he said, "There is no deity but God. Receive news, O fisherman." "Of what?" said the fisherman. "Those you give me news," he answered. "Oh, the being instantly put in the most cruel death," the fisherman exclaimed. "You deservest for the news, O master of the ephrits, the withdrawal of protection from thee. Oh, though remote, wherefore would you kill me? And what requires the killing me, when I have liberated thee from the bottle, and rescued thee from the bottom of the sea, and brought thee up upon the dry land?" The ephrit answered, "Choose what kind of death thou wilt die, and in what manner you shalt be killed." "What is my offence?" said the fisherman, "that this should be my recompense from thee?" The ephrit replied, "Hear my story, O fisherman." "Tell it then," said the fisherman, "and be short in thy words, for my soul has sunk down to my feet." "Know then," said he, "that I am one of the heretical jinn. I rebelled against Sulaiman, the son of Daud. I am Shaka the genie, and he sent to me his vizier, Asaf the son of Pakia, who came upon me forcibly and took me to him in bonds and placed me before him. And when Sulaiman saw me, he offered up a prayer for protection against me, and exhorted me to embrace the faith and to submit to his authority. But I refused the bond which he called for his bottle, and confirmed in me, and closed it upon with me, the leaden stopper which he stamped into the most great name. Then he gave order to the jinn, who carried me away, and threw me into the midst of the sea. Then I remained 100 years, and I said in my heart, "Whosoever shall liberate me, I will enrich him forever." but the 100 years passed over me, and no one liberated me. And I entered upon another 100 year, and I said, whosoever shall liberate me, I will open to him the treasures of the earth. But no one did so. And for 100 years more passed over me, and I said, whosoever shall liberate me, I will perform for him 3 wants. But still no one liberated me. I then fell into a violent rage, and said within myself, whosoever shall liberate me now, I will kill him, and only suffer him to choose in what manner he will die. And lo, now you deliberated me, and I have given thee my choice to the manner of which done will thee. When the fisherman had heard the story of the Ifrit, he exclaimed, O Allah, that I should not have liberated thee, but in such a time of this? Then said he to the Ifrit, pardon me, and kill me not, and so may God pardon thee, and destroy me not, lest God give power over thee to one who will destroy thee. The Marid answered, I must positively kill thee. Therefore choose by what manner of death you will die. The fisherman then felt assured of his death, but he again implored the Ifrit, saying, pardon me by way of gratitude for my liberating thee. Why, answered the Ifrit, I am not going to kill thee, but for that very reason, because you hast liberated me. O Sheikh of the Ifrits, said the fisherman, do I act kindly towards thee, and dost you recompense me with baseness? But the proverb leans not to the saint. We did God to them, and they returned us the contrary, and such, by my life, is the conduct of the wicked. Then he who acted kindly to the undeserving is recompensed in the same manner as the aider of the Amir. The Ifrit, when he heard this word, answered by saying, covet not life, for the death is unavoidable. Then said the fisherman with himself, this is a jinn, and I am a man, and God hath given me sound reason. Therefore I will not plot his destruction with any art of my reason, like as he has plotted with the cunning and perfidy. So he said to the Ifrit, hast thou determined to kill me? He answered, yes. Then said he, by the most great name engraved upon the seal of Sulaiman, I will ask thee one question, and will thou answer it to me truly. On hearing the mention of the most great name, the Ifrit was agitated and trembled, and replied, yes, ask and be brief. The fisherman then said, how vast thou in this bottle? It will not contain the hand of my foot. How then they contain in the whole body? Dost thou not believe that I was it in? Said the Ifrit. The fisherman answered, I will never believe thee until I see thee in. Upon this the Ifrit shook and became converted again into smoke, which rose to the sky and then became condensed and entered the bottle by little and little until it was all enclosed. When the fisherman hastily snatched the sealed leaden stopper and having replaced in the mouth of the bottle, called out to the Ifrit and said, choose in what manner of death thou wilt die. I will assuredly throw thee here into the sea and build me a house on this spot, and whosoever shall come here, I will prevent his fishing in this place, and will say to him, here is an Ifrit, who to any person that liberates him will propose various kinds of death, and then give him this choice of one of them. On hearing these words of the fisherman, the Ifrit endeavored to escape, but could not, finding himself restrained by the impression of the seal of Sulaiman, and thus imprisoned by the fishermen at the vilest and filthiest and least of Ifrits. The fishermen took the bottle to brink of the sea. The Ifrit exclaimed, "Nay, nay," to which the fishermen answered, "Yea, without fail, yea, without fail." The Marid, then addressing him with a soft voice and humble manner, said, "What dost thou intend to do with me, O fisherman?" He answered, "I will throw thee into the sea, and if you thou hast been there 1,800 years, I will make thee to remain there until the hour of judgment. Did I not say to thee, spare me? And so may God spare thee, and destroy me not, lest God destroy thee. But thou didst reject my petition, and wouldest nothing but treachery. Therefore, God hath caused thee to fall into my hand, and I have betrayed thee. Open to me," said the Ifrit, "that I may confer benefits upon thee." The fisherman replied, "Thou liest, you accost, and I thou are like the vizier of King Joan and the Said Doban." "What," said the Ifrit, "was the case of the vizier, King Joan, and the Said Doban, and what is their story?" The fisherman answered as follows.